Program will begin momentarily.
Good morning. On behalf of the Department of Pharmacy Practice, the School of Pharmacy, and the University of Mississippi, we are delighted to have you here today for our 2016 Coy W. Waller Distinguished Lecture. Dean David Allen will open up our program by sharing the history and significance of this lecture series. After the lecture, we welcome any questions from the audience. Students will be available to provide you a microphone during that time. It is now my pleasure to welcome Dean David Allen.
Thank you, Stina. Good morning, everyone. I very much appreciate you being here today. I'd like to begin by thanking the Department of Pharmacy Practice for co-hosting this event. And I'd also like to thank Dr. John Murphy for serving as our 2016 Waller Lecturer. John is a longtime friend of mine, a really funny guy, which I think you'll probably pick up on in a few minutes, and an absolutely incredible educator in clinical pharmacists. You'll hear more about him in a few minutes. It's my great honor each year to tell you a little bit about Dr. Coy W. Waller, an amazing man with a truly amazing legacy in natural products research. We have honored Dr. Waller with this lecture series since 2004. Dr. Waller was born in 1914 in North Carolina. He received his bachelor's degree in pharmacy from the University of North Carolina, his master's in microanalytical chemistry from the University of Buffalo, and his doctorate in pharmaceutical chemistry from the University of Minnesota. He began his long tenure with the University of Mississippi in 1968 as the Associate Director of the Research Institute for Pharmaceutical Sciences. He became its first full-time director 2 years later. He advanced the Institute in numerous ways. His focus on natural products as a source of new pharmaceuticals laid the foundation for the eventual creation of our National Center for Natural Products Research, the first of now three centers, soon to be four, in the Research Institute. Before retiring in 1979, Dr. Waller conducted research on poison ivy and the use of cannabinoids to treat glaucoma, and he helped edit bibliographies on marijuana and cocaine. In 1993, the university honored him by dedicating the Coy W. Waller Laboratory Complex, a natural products laboratory that houses our marijuana garden, medicinal plant garden, and greenhouses. Over the course of his career, Dr. Waller authored more than 50 patents, which were issued in more than 150 countries. He was passionate about inspiring young students and colleagues to pursue natural products research and to realize their potential to develop new pharmaceutical products. Dr. Waller was one of the most accomplished scientists of his time. We are incredibly grateful for his contributions to our school, our nation, and the world. When Dr. Waller passed on April 24, 1998, the School of Pharmacy lost an inspirational leader, and the world lost a research pioneer. I'm so happy to see some of Dr. Waller's family here today. Mrs. Deb Waller-Carnathan, Mrs. Liz Waller-Thomas, and Mr. Keith Thomas, Mr. David Waller, and Ms. Amy Evans. Would Dr. Waller's family please stand so that we can recognize? Truly appreciate your presence here today. We're grateful to you and your family for your so many contributions to our school pharmacy. I would like to now welcome back Dr. Haynes to the podium, chair of our Department of Pharmacy Practice, who will introduce our speaker for this year, Dr. Murphy. Stina?
Thank you, David. It is my privilege and honor to introduce the 2016 Coy Waller Distinguished Lecturer, Dr. John E. Murphy. John is the Associate Dean for Academic Affairs and the Professor of Pharmacy Practice and Science at the University of Arizona College of Pharmacy. He received his BS in Pharmacy and his PharmD from the University of Florida in Gainesville. During the course of his career, he has served as Interim Dean of the College of Pharmacy at the University of Arizona and was named Honorary Professor at the University of Otago School of Pharmacy in Dunedin, New Zealand. His key research interests are in preventing harmful drug-to-drug interactions, clinical pharmacokinetics, and pharmacy education. He has conducted extensive research on pharmacokinetic services of hospital pharmacists. During his time as residency coordinator at Georgia Baptist Medical Center in Atlanta, he helped create one of the first formal pharmacokinetic monitoring services. He has made significant contributions to our profession through academic accomplishments, clinical practice advancement, and service to the profession. As president-elect of the American College of Clinical Pharmacists, he took the lead in evaluating the pharmacist's role in medication therapy. He has also served as the president of the American Society of Health System Pharmacists and the Georgia Society of Hospital Pharmacists, and is an investigator with the University of Arizona Center for Health Outcomes and Pharmacoeconomic Research. Among his numerous professional teaching recognitions are the awards for sustained contributions to the literature of pharmacy practice from the American Society of Health System Pharmacists Research and Education Foundation, the ASHP Whitney Award, the ACCP Educator Award, and the Robert K. Chalmers Distinguished Teaching Award from the American Association of Colleges of Pharmacy. He also received the Distinguished Pharmacy Alumnus Award from the University of Florida in 1998. Over his prolific career, John has published more than 200 papers, 100 abstracts, 5 editions of Clinical Pharmacokinetics, and is the co-editor of the Pharmacotherapy Self-Assessment Program. The Department of Pharmacy Practice is absolutely thrilled to have John with us today as he presents a talk entitled Pharmacy World Domination. Please join me in welcoming Dr. John Murphy.
Thank you very much, Dr. Haynes and Dean Allen, for inviting me here. It is a true honor to come here. My first name in 1991. Thank you, Waller family, for coming to listen to me talk about world domination. It's a true honor to be named as a lecturer in Dr. Waller's name. He was such an inspirational person. Distinguished faculty, amazing students. I'm really glad to be here, and I'm glad to hear there were no hisses when she said University of Florida. So how many think medications are inherently beneficial? Good, good. How many think they're totally safe? Good, nobody. You've heard that we consume about $100 to $200 billion a year with the problems associated with medications, and somewhere between 100,000 and 200,000 people die from misadventures associated with medications. Well, I bet you also know that pharmacists can do something about that. So what we need is pharmacy world domination. So let's see how we get there. I want to talk about some of the things that are associated with the history of pharmacy and getting to this place in pharmacy. So I'm going to discuss a little bit of the evolution, not too much early, but a little bit of clinical pharmacy evolution or the direct patient care practice. I wanted to describe some areas of continuing need for the profession. And I want to discuss some of the contemporary issues related to advancing the profession and how individual pharmacists, that means you, can do something about making us dominant in the practice of pharmacy and in the care of patients. Now, I don't want you to think that I mean that pharmacy is everything. We're going to work together as an interprofessional team to make care better for our patients. But what I don't think is that we've been as in the forefront as we need to be based on what we already know that pharmacists can do to make care better for our patients. So let's do a few things here. Pharmacy, we've come a long way, right? We started out perhaps botanists. We were natural product selectors, and Dr. Waller was certainly involved in this, but I'm going a long way back even from that. We learned some separation techniques so we could make our products purer and more effective. We learned about compounding. And then we moved into the 20th century. And I decided, This is the problem, okay. Just in case somebody waved to me, I'm trying to do two things at once. So I don't stare at you. Maybe I'm just gonna stare at this then, okay. I'll try it this way. So, the 20th century, the bad old days. Why would I call it the bad old days? Well, I'll tell you what. Abraham Flexner, the architect of change in medical education, he revolutionized the way doctors were educated in the early 20th century. He said, plumbing, social work, banking, and pharmacy were non-professional because they were unintellectual. Anybody unhappy about that? Don't forget, this was when we were selling snake oil. Unintellectual, highly profit motivated, lacked a technique of their own, and lacked a primary responsibility. So I would say probably only banking still does that. Sorry. Any parents that are bankers, I'm sorry. All right, APHA Code of Ethics, you may know this. 1922 to 1969 said the pharmacist should never discuss the therapeutic edict of a physician's prescription with a patron or disclose details of the composition which the physician has withheld, suggesting to the patient that such details can be properly discussed with the prescriber only. Now, what I really liked about this was the P was capitalized. So that's kind of like God, right? That's the way you write God when you do these things. So I love physicians, so I'm not trying to put them down, but the fact that we would put capital P kind of troubles me a bit. All right, there were pioneers, though, who were not willing to maintain that status quo. Well, let's look a little bit at clinical pharmacy history. And I just want to tell you that Bob Ellenboss and Dennis Worthen wrote this book called The Pharmacy in the U.S. Transformation of a Profession in 2009, and I'm going to borrow heavily from some of that, describing how we went from the area where we were preparing products for patients, very important, to the place where the pharmaceutical industry took over most of that, and we began to transition to be more clinically oriented, and this will be how we get to the point where we need to be world dominant. I added some additional information since 2009. All right, some of the early advances in the 60s and 70s, the first accredited residency was at Thomas Jefferson in 63. In 1966, there was a ninth floor project at UCSF, California, San Francisco. They sent a bunch of pharmacists up to the ninth floor of the hospital to try to figure out what they could do up there. That became transformational in the way education occurred. In 1966, the American Association of Colleges of Pharmacy defined clinical pharmacy and what it meant in this transformation of our profession. In 1969, Charlie Walton outlined the professional roles of education for clinical pharmacists. I started pharmacy school in 1973, so this was just before those kinds of things were happening. I did want to say Dr. Haynes put me as a pioneer of pharmacy, so I think that mostly means I'm really old. So I've been around for a long time. This was my transition. In 1972, pharmacists practiced with that. What I think, though, is it's not a full-time part of every practice, and I think we need to move forward from there. 1975, Applied Therapeutics was first published. I have a copy in my office, so that does show you how old I am. 1976, we had the first international conference on clinical pharmacy education. So not only were we in the U.S. trying to advance clinical pharmacy, we were also meeting with pharmacists from around the world to try to enhance the clinical practice of pharmacy and move us to direct patient care. In 1976, the Board of Pharmaceutical Specialties was established, and that's something obviously that I'm engaged with the Pharmacotherapy Self-Assessment Program, but it's something that pharmacists have been using to document their skills and advance their opportunities in healthcare. 1977, collaborative drug therapy management bill was passed in California so pharmacists could do that. In 1978, ASHP published the Statement on Clinical Functions in Institutional Pharmacies. So you see this movement is gathering steam as time passes. Now let's go to a slightly more recent history, a look at approximately 35 years of progress in clinical pharmacy. So why role of the pharmacist and why 35 years? Well, many papers in the early days describe new pharmacy services. And I did a PubMed search in September on role of the pharmacist, and there were 5,614 citations. I graduated 35 years ago, and this is all about me, right? No, but actually it was a time frame I was interested in, so that's what you have to listen to. Sorry. So how did I come to this? I got a BS in pharmacy in 76 and a PharmD in 79, all at the University of Florida. And good things came from that. And I think one should always say thanks. I like the Woodrow Wilson quote, I not only use all the brains I have, but all that I can borrow, and I've borrowed a lot over the years, so anything that I've done has been through the work of a lot of different people. I wanted to give a little shout out to your new chancellor. He talks about the power of higher education, and he says creating a better future for individuals and communities. And I have to thank my parents because, to be honest, I owe everything in my career to their foresight around the value of higher learning. And I know many of you here, and most of you here, believe in the power of higher learning, and you're certainly getting educated in a very beneficial and useful profession. Had to sneak that in. My grandfather was also a pharmacist, and I got to observe him in community pharmacy practice doing what he could do to help patients get better. And he was very adamant about paying special attention to the prescription and making sure it fit the patient correctly, and always checking to make sure he wasn't causing any problems for the patients he had. I also had a lot of mentors. When I graduated in 76, I got to go become a research pharmacist at the Bayfront Medical Center, and my mentor in that picture is Jerry Hood. And what we did was try to figure out if we could help patients take their medications better by giving them a calendar. You guys will all make apps for them and help them in that way. But this is the primitive way we did it in those days. All right, on to the best career ever. Students, there are so many careers in pharmacy. Academia is the best one. Right, faculty? Yeah. So, my first stop was at Mercer University School of Pharmacy, and again, I have to say thanks. They gave me very many opportunities to succeed in the profession, including my opportunities to be the president of the Georgia Society, for example. But I also got to be director of clinical pharmacokinetic services. And Dr. Haynes pointed out this was probably the first private practice service in a hospital in the country, and we ran that for 10 years while I was in Georgia, the hospital paying for us to take care of their patients. I moved on to the University of Arizona, and Dr. Haynes said all the things that I do. But again, I wanted to thank the university for a very supportive environment. They allowed me to serve on the board of ASHP and as president and president of ACCP as well. So those opportunities that you get where you work are critical to creating your future. They also allow me to do some of this. So this is my other passion. And I just want to tell you, this is not a mall magazine. I didn't go in there and put my picture on it. This is a real magazine. Of course, the only reason I'm on there is that thing in the middle, not me. All right, let's talk now clinical pharmacy, 1979 to the present. I told you why that sort of time period. Organizations started defining things around direct patient care and clinical pharmacy. And ACCP calls it a health science discipline in which pharmacists provide patient care that optimizes medication therapy and promotes health and disease prevention. We're going to see a lot of these different things that the organizations say we're all about. They bring some constant themes throughout. They also say, as a discipline, we have an obligation to contribute to the generation of new knowledge that advances health and quality of life. And that'll be a theme I'll talk about as we go forward as well. I also wanted to point out, ASHP is actively involved in promoting clinical practice around the world. So they've gone to Basel in Switzerland and met with international colleagues to talk about the things that pharmacists should be doing in hospitals around the world. And this is their revised statement on the goal of hospital pharmacists, is to optimize patient outcomes through collaborative, interprofessional, responsible use of medicines and medical devices. I would submit to you that we could remove hospital because this is a goal of every pharmacist. Let's go back on a few other things. 1981, new journals came out, Pharmacotherapy. 1982, Clinical Pharmacy by ASHP, which they later combined into AJHP and put it out twice monthly. 1983, FDA said that pharmacists can be principal investigators on grants. Very important because we're working with our other healthcare colleagues, and this is the kind of respect we need to be able to create the research that's important to change care for our patients. 1984, 15 years after APHA said we shouldn't be talking to our patients, we now have a patient counseling competition for students. So 15 years it took to change it around that much, but I think that was a major change. In 1987, APHA established a clinical sciences section. 1989, ACPE told us we were all going to be PharmDs. Now, you guys don't remember that kind of history, but I'm bringing it back to you. Now, of course, everybody is PharmD. In 1989, the Joint Commission on Pharmacy Practitioners said the mission of pharmacy is to help people make the best use of their medications. In 1990, APHA said our mission is to serve society as the profession responsible for appropriate use of medications, devices, and services to achieve optimal therapeutic outcomes. When I went to pharmacy school in the bachelor's program, my clinical practice as part of the BS was 3 hours in one quarter at a community pharmacy. I learned how to make sure patients got the right doses and the right, right form, and it was the right patient. But when they walked out the door, that was it. There was no consideration of whether it was working for them, what the outcomes were. Those early days really are the things that have to change the most. Hillary Clinton, in a speech to the National Association of Chain Drugs in 1993, said, "The future of pharmacy lies in your ability to provide services, not just drugs." I'm not going to say anything about politics, but if she happens to win on Tuesday, let's go talk to her about this. Because there are some things we need to make sure that we have the opportunity to do this. 1994, first organized movement to train pharmacists to immunize. Who's that? Operation Immunization this week, I think. That's because I follow the dean's Facebook page. He's always promoting you guys in case you aren't on that. 1995, the VA established prescribing authority for clinical pharmacists. All right, here's a quiz. Which of the following pharmacy clinical services have largely transitioned from specialist providers to general practice clinicians? PK, counseling, geriatric care, renal dosing, drug information, or all of the above? I hope you say all of the above. When we had our private practice kinetic service, we were really specialists in the area. Now there are probably over 90% of all hospitals have pharmacokinetic services, and it's not done by specialists, it's done by all of you guys that are going to be out there practicing. So, is that important? I think it's important because it means that we're all expected to do these things. 1995, National Technician Certification begins. How important is that? We have well-trained technicians that allow us the opportunity to go out and do the things that change the way medications are used by our public and the outcomes associated with them. 1995, Johnson & Boutman estimated a $76 billion cost and 200,000 deaths from drug-related morbidity and mortality. I opened with that. This was, obviously 95 was a long time ago, and the dollars have increased dramatically. Pharmacists have been shown to make a difference in this. We have to do world domination. 1996, Schumacher evaluated trials of economic benefit of clinical pharmacy services. Return on investment, $4 for every $1 invested. That's a no-brainer, right? Let's invest $1 to get $4 back. 1996, Project Impact, hyperlipidemia. Two-thirds of patients meet goals when pharmacists monitor them for hyperlipidemia treatment. You know, the statistics are that about 25% of patients take their hyperlipidemia drug after a year. So pharmacists making a difference. 2005, the Joint Commission on Pharmacy Practitioners, which is a group of 11 pharmacy organizations, said pharmacy will be the healthcare professionals responsible for providing patient care that ensures optimal medication therapy outcomes. Ensuring outcomes, not like when I did my clerkship in bachelor's of pharmacy, handing out medicine, letting people go out willy-nilly, no responsibility for the outcomes. And they said pharmacists will have the authority and autonomy to manage medication therapy and will be accountable. So we have to be accountable too. All right, I want to go back to BPS for a second. Nuclear pharmacy, 1978. I said 1979 onward, I cheated a little. Nutrition support, 88, pharmacotherapy, 88, psych, 92, onc, 96, and they came up with an idea for added qualifications for cardiology and ID in 97. So you see kind of a very slow movement from nutrition, but considering, I got to quit doing this. BPS is also considering solid organ transplants, sterile compounding, pain and palliative care, and something that had been kind of an anomaly was the certified geriatric pharmacist. It was off from BPS, now will be folded in. So many specialties available to you students as you go out there, depending on the type of practice that you want to have. 1980, going back in time, standards for clinical pharmacy practice and specialized pharmacy residency training approved. Residency training is so important in my mind, and we need so many more so students have the opportunity to do that. 86, APHA and the American College of Apothecaries established community pharmacy residency guidelines. So you see all of these things are moving us to that direct patient care profession where we can really make a difference in the outcomes for our patients. 92, ASHP merged the residencies into residency and pharmacy practice. In 2000, the ASHP House of Delegates adopted a policy to say that pharmacists practicing direct patient care should have completed a residency or have attained comparable skills through practice experiences. Now, I put something totally out of time context here because I just came back from the ACCP meeting, and they are interested in examining offerings to help current pharmacists gain comparable skills. And I think that's critically important because the shortage of residencies relative to the demand is so high, and I want to make sure everybody has the opportunity to gain those kinds of skills. 2005, ASHP changed the terminology to PGY1 and PGY2, and they required that the specialties came after the general residency. In 2006, ACCP published its vision of the future for residency training on graduation as a prerequisite to direct patient care by 2020. I happen to be the leader author on that with a phenomenal group, and it's something that has raised quite a bit of interest in both positive and negative ways, but it's certainly caused a great increase in the number of residency programs and residency slots so that pharmacy students have the opportunity to go do those. ASHP passed a similar policy, but APHA, AACP, and AMCP defeated similar policies, but we keep working on them. We'll get them there someday. All right, how about organizations? There was always APHA forever, I think, certainly beyond my memory. ASHP came about 50, National Community Pharmacy Association. Then a bunch started coming, ACCP and Pediatric Pharmacy in 79. 87, APHA developed a clinical sciences section. I mentioned that earlier. 90, Society for Critical Care Medicine created a section on clinical pharmacology and pharmacy. So this was a physician group, and they decided pharmacists needed to be in there. And I'm proud to say that there have been at least three presidents of this organization that still is primarily physicians who are pharmacists. So we're making impact among the professions. Society of Infectious Diseases Pharmacists, ACCP formed its first practice research networks in 92, and 98, the College of Psychiatric and Neurologic Pharmacists. Some important conferences went on to try to get us thinking about being direct patient care providers. ASHP's Direction for Clinical Practice and Pharmacy, commonly known as the Hilton Head Conference, because that's where they held it, represented a commitment to the establishment of pharmacy as a true clinical profession. In 93, ASHP held a pharmaceutical care conference, a new term that talked about pharmacists being responsible for outcomes with medications. In 94, there was a third conference in the 3rd Pharmacy in the 21st Century Conference. Carl Trinko, who was AACP CEO, smashed accounting trade to celebrate the demise of dispensing as pharmacists' main responsibility. Now, one thing we have to do is we have to get to all newsrooms, because every time I see something on pharmacy in the news, they always bring out an avid accounting trade, right? As if that's the only thing we do. We gotta get rid of that. We gotta get them showing us working with patients, not counting pills, which the technicians largely do. How about payment for services? 1979, Blue Cross reimbursed the Ohio State for pharmacokinetic consults. In 81, we had our private practice pharmacokinetics group. In 93, a coalition was put together from pharmacy organizations for consumer access to pharmaceutical care, obviously associated with getting paid for these services. In 1996, Wisconsin Medicaid implemented an incentive-based pharmacy payment system to increase patient compliance and prevent adverse drug reactions, with the understanding that pharmacists could do something to help patients in these arenas. I skipped ahead again. 2014, the major pharmacy organizations have gotten together to seek provider status, and they've got something like 350 legislators signed on to this, so maybe if Congress ever starts working again, we'll actually get provider status in the next year or so. Fingers crossed, before I retire. Ready. All right, let me ask a question though. The greatest barriers to advancing direct patient care activities of pharmacists is lack of recognition as patient care providers and payment for these services. Anybody true? Anybody false? Well, I hope I've shown you that we already do these things. I think we need payment for services, and we need provider status, but that hasn't held us back. We're out there doing it, and you guys will keep doing it no matter what happens. Collaborative practice, 79, Washington was the second state to enact legislation enabling pharmacists to prescribe under protocol. 86, Florida allowed independent prescribing. 97, 14 states and the VA allowed some sort of collaborative prescribing. 2003, just 6 years later, 38 states and the VA allowed drug therapy management. And by 2006, 95% of VAs have pharmacists with prescribing privileges providing these services. I just wanted to point this out in case you're interested in state pharmacist collaborative practice laws. There was an article presented in 2006 in AJHP by Hill. go look it up if you're interested in seeing all the things that are going on. 1998, the Healthcare Financing Administration approved the Mississippi Plan to allow disease management by pharmacists. I know many faculty from the University of Mississippi were involved in making that happen. Pat yourselves on the back. Good job done. 2001, ASHP and ACCP formed the Pharmacist Provider Coalition to gain recognition of pharmacists as healthcare providers. Now remember, I just said 2014, they joined again. So 2001 to 2014, we didn't get it done then, but I think we're going to get it done now. 2003, everybody knows about the Prescription Drug Act, allowing for NTM, which has certainly revolutionized a good part of pharmacy. All right, let's focus a little bit on the current state of things. Phone warrior. Anybody work in a pharmacy? We spend a lot of time on the phone dealing with insurance companies and other things of that nature. Certainly has kind of always been that way, something we need to continue to refine. But we're also becoming more and more patient care providers. And something that Dr. Haynes mentioned that I'm interested in, drug-drug interactions. Don't take any of these red pills. If that doesn't work, don't take any of the blue ones. That's probably not very effective use of it, but they don't take it, no drug interactions, right? Wanted to point out, clinical pharmacy services are growing. Cab Bond and Cindy Rail did a series of pharmacotherapy where they looked at the services provided in institutions. Unfortunately, Cab passed away and they haven't done any since, but ADR management doubled in 7 years. Drug protocol management tripled. Drug therapy monitoring 150%. Medical rounds almost fourfold. Pharmacokinetic consults more than doubled, and drug information more than doubled. Schneider and Peterson and HHP also do similar things to this, and what you find is the numbers keep rising. Important pharmacy services being provided in institutions and certainly in ambulatory care and community settings as well. So, Cab Bond and Cindy Rail looked at these services and tried to figure out, did it make a difference on patient outcomes? So these are the things that they looked at to see which ones changed mortality for patients. People dying. So which do you think it might be? I'm not going to quiz you on this. What I'm going to say, though, most disappointing to me as a PK guy, it was therapeutic drug monitoring. Now, there was a trend, but not statistically significant. All of these things, if we do them in institutions, lead to better outcomes for our patients. All right. Role of the pharmacist in. Remember I said I got 5,614 hits when I did that on PubMed? So here's a few of them. MTM, hypertension, dialysis, HIV. Collaborative practice, med errors, antimicrobial stewardship. Okay. I don't know what that role is, but it's interesting. Drug-resistant TB, emergency department, sports pharmacy. Migraine. Domestic abuse, we actually, a colleague and I wrote that one. Choosing non-steroidals, asthma care, chronic pain I think even more important. I'm a little afraid that the pendulum, because of the opioid epidemic, is gonna swing the other way, so patients with chronic pain are gonna have challenges getting their medication, and we as pharmacists can help separate out the problem from the patients that need those medications. Execution. I didn't want to follow that one too much, but some of the things we can do. Okay, what are some of the services that might be least well developed now that may increase considerably in the next 5 to 10 years? Medical home, pharmacogenomics, medication therapy management, or conducting research. Well, I would say probably genomics. I think medical home more too, but I think we're well involved in NTM and conducting research. I think genomics is going to be one of the things that pharmacy students should be interested in, and as pharmacists will learn more about as well. All right, quickly I'm going to go through becoming the visible ingredient. When I was president of ASHP, part of my talk was about being the visible ingredient. At the time, there was a video that was called The Invisible Ingredient, and it was about all the great services pharmacists did behind the scenes. So I took the videotape and I ripped it apart and threw it on the floor because I think we have to become the visible ingredient in healthcare, not the invisible ingredient. So what is visible? Perceptible, apparent, obvious, palpable, unmistakable, or ominous. Things we need to do. I'm having trouble. I think it's like walking and chewing gum at the same time. I'm not good at that either. Alright, so I don't want us to be this. I want us to move to becoming the visible ingredient. Let me talk about a few things. One day I was driving home and Lucian Leap is on the radio. He's a prominent Harvard physician who's probably one of the most well-known people about medication, about preventing medication errors. He said, if you want to prevent medication errors in the ICU, visibility in a lot of different areas. But there's also a lot of other areas where we aren't. I think that we have to always talk about what we're doing when we're doing it for patients and other healthcare providers. We don't want to act like this. It's not a Goliath thing that we have to bang our head up against. But I have a charge to you, and that charge is to become the visible ingredient in your practice. Let every patient and healthcare provider know who you are and what you do for them. If you're in the hospital, go shake your patient's hand or pat them on the shoulder. If you're giving your immunizations, make sure everybody knows you're a pharmacist doing that for them, and ask them about their other immunizations too, if they're up to date. If you're in a community pharmacy and you're checking a dose and you're checking drug interactions, tell the patient what you're doing for them. Let them know when you counsel them why you're doing it, and remind them that they can call you if anything comes up. So that's my charge. All right. Sorry. The future. The great sports philosopher Yogi Berra said it's difficult to make predictions, especially about the future. But some things I know. Interprofessional teams are going to be a big, certainly the way we practice. And I know you guys do great IPE here, so you're getting prepared for that. IOM said we should all be educated together. There have been various IOM, which is now the National Academy of Medicine, reports on practice and education. Okay, stop that part. There's a National Center for Interprofessional Education and Practice. If you haven't visited their website, go for it. There's also there are core competencies for interprofessional collaborative practice by the Interprofessional Education Collaborative. Guess who is part of that collaborative? Pharmacy. There are now about 12 different disciplines involved in that. Go check out their website as well. So where do we need to go from here? Payment for services. I'm hoping we'll get there. I don't know how it's going to change over time, because maybe we're not getting paid for widgets, we're getting paid to keep a patient well. Public health, we definitely need to do more in public health as pharmacists. We know there are so many problems that we can help with. More comparative effectiveness research of clinical services. What do we need that makes a difference for our patients? We need more research. Pharmacists are doing great research. We need more. We need to show the value of our profession. And then maybe independent prescribing. We already have prescribing privileges in almost every state in a collaborative arrangements, but maybe independent will come. So here's what Paul Abramowitz, the CEO of ASHP, has to say about that. He says there's no other profession that focuses as much of its education and training on the science and therapeutic use of drugs as the profession of pharmacy, and as members of the same interprofessional team, physicians should diagnose and pharmacists should prescribe. You know, I've asked some of my physician colleagues about it. A lot of them say, that would be awesome. Or, you know, some say, man, I'm not sure. But we'll win them over eventually. Some other areas of continuing need. We need more residency training positions and sites. So students, when you get out, if you do a residency, make sure you start a residency after it. We need to continue to separate ourselves from personally dispensing the product, and we need to continue to move toward taking responsibility for patients' medication therapy. Pharmacy world domination. Dan Cobal was talking about some ASHP surveys that they do in hospitals. He said, major medication safety advances have occurred over the past 15 years in U.S. hospitals and health systems. And these system improvements, including enhanced clinical pharmacy services, have coincided with a 16% decrease in adverse drug events in hospitals. Helping patients through pharmacy services. He further said, institutions reporting daily monitoring of greater than 75% of the patients by pharmacists increased from 20 to 60%. 5 years. Amazing. We are getting traction. And the pharmacists increasingly have the authority to order labs and adjust. Oh, sorry. Okay, sorry. Walking at you again. Not getting there. Sorry. All right. Greater than 75% of patients by pharmacists increased from 20 to 60%, and staff with PGY1 residency training increased from 14% to 24%. BPS certification from 6 to 17%. Remember ASHP. Remember ASHP has put out a policy suggesting that as we move forward in the profession, that pharmacists should be doing residencies to participate in these practices. Bill Zellmer said drug therapy is becoming complex and riskier, demanding more attention from pharmacists. He said, as physicians and nurses in training observe the value of pharmacists, they'll insist that a pharmacist be on their team when they step into leadership roles. When I started in clinical pharmacy, people weren't on the floors. And we just went up and started doing things. We were kind of clueless. We just did what we could. When we were doing our pharmacokinetic service, when we first did our consults, we called the physicians every time. After about two calls, they said, just do it. You know, they figured out that you were competent. They wanted you to go ahead and do it. You know, they came in and signed up afterwards. Physicians and nurses understand the value that you provide. No David and Goliath. Just get it done. So where to from here? I say the enemies of pharmacy are patient suffering, disease, death, and waste of resources. And pharmacists can do much to help. It's time for world domination. Pharmacists need to be at the forefront of change in healthcare, providing new models of caring for our citizens. And we must all take the time to provide stories to our government leaders so they can visualize our value. We've been in an election for 4.5 years now, I think. That's at least what it seems. They operate on sound bites, so make sure you get your sound bite ready whenever you talk to one of them. All right, let's take a little different look at the past and the future. So this is how I calculated when I went to college. Actually, I did have a slide rule. And finally, these guys came along. They were about $1 billion, but not quite that bad. The original computer. This is probably a 5 kilobyte computer. And maybe that's an Apple computer, I'm not so sure. How about video? I think you did pictures and video this way. This is how we recorded ourselves, or maybe even reel-to-reel. That's how we listen to radios. That's how we watch TV. And that's how we play games. Now we all do it this way. This guy I'm going to recommend you get to his website, and I'll show it later, but he's all about dematerialization, what happens. See the little red arrow? He says $900,000 worth of applications are now in a smartphone. He took the original price of all these things when they came out, and then he put it into $2011, and it's $900,000. All of those are done on your smartphone now. Digital recorder, watch, camera, library, video player, camera, music player, encyclopedia, etc., etc. How about getting a ring? We still all do this, right? That's what I'm looking for. I want the hot tub in there, too. Well, you think that people have been thinking about autonomous for a while? 1957. We're getting there, though. Uber's all over it, right? Philadelphia. How about deliveries? I'd say it's going to be autonomous everything. Isn't this crazy for rural practice, don't you think? There's going to be a way to get medicines to patients that would have consumed so many resources. I'm so excited about these kind of things. Education. That looks kind of like my lab when I went to pharmacy school. And there's my kinetics class. Not really. Not quite that bad. Education. More personalized, collaborative, informal, competence-based, supported by flexible, woven, dynamic environments and a range of tools. Mini virtual. I know you guys are already experiencing this. Maybe some will look like that. Maybe some will look like that. How about interacting with each other? Around the TV before, around the kitchen table now, if we ever sit at a kitchen table together. This is what it looks like. How about healthcare? From Star Trek. Damn it, Jim. I'm a doctor, not an emergency medical hologram. We remember our holograms from Star Wars. There's actually an X Prize. Or developing devices that will diagnose like it was in Star Trek. This made me look at how we diagnose folks. How about this? We'll just hologram our family into the office somewhere. Virtual team. Patient, physician, and pharmacist. Nowhere near each other. Virtual environment. So this guy Diamandis, again, here's his website. If you like future-y kind of things, he's really cool with that. He says, in terms of diagnosis, AI is already better than physicians, artificial intelligence. Robots are going to do our surgery because they're going to be better. They won't have any coffee shake or anything. Of course, physicians often use robots already. Elder care, robots for our parents and for me in a few years, can sit with us and help take care of us. In medicine, he says artificial intelligence will lead to faster drug discovery and manufacturing and 3D printing. Cool things on the horizon, things we need to think about as educators. President Obama wrote an article and he said, now is the greatest time to be alive. He said he's optimistic because of the constant churn of scientific progress. He said we need to accelerate change from everyone. The little girl dreaming of an app in the middle of a farm in Iowa to the scientist at Stanford. He says we'll overcome the challenges we face by unleashing the power of all of us for all of us. We must embrace that quintessentially American compulsion to race for new frontiers and push the boundaries of what is possible. And I would say to you, this is happening in every country. Everybody is working to push those boundaries. So, let's charge into the future with the same determination shown over the last 35 years. Our patients deserve our best efforts. It's time they all get them. Pharmacy for Thank you, my friend and colleagues. That's the end.
Thank you, John, for sharing that story of our rich history of a profession and targets for practice advancement. So now is the time we open the floor for questions. Any attendees have a question? There are microphones and students who I think will be assisting you in asking Dr. Murphy any questions you may have.
Don't be shy.
Thank you. Enjoyed your talk very much today. As far as world domination, do you think there's any restriction that, or going toward that, has been because of the fractionation of the profession into so many different organizations? So if you could comment on that, appreciate it. And just, I was wondering whether you knew how much Hillary got for that talk.
I'm sure he does. They all get a good amount for those kinds of speeches. So the question related to, is the organization splitting? To me, people join organizations for the things that they can do for them, and it's often how they affiliate. So, I mean, personally, probably because I'm an academic, I'm in a lot of different organizations, and each one has a different value to me. But I know, for example, my colleague as he's an emergency pharmacist. He asked me the other day, should we form an emergency pharmacist organization? Well, I think in part that has to do with what they wanted to do together as emergency pharmacists. I think ACCP wanted to push clinical pharmacy faster than ASHP was pushing it. ASHP was certainly part of APHA at one time. They split off again. I think the opportunity to focus meeting programming and things of that nature. But what I have seen that probably is beneficial is like the Joint Commission of Pharmacy Practitioners. So that's all the 11 major organizations that get together twice a year to talk about things that they can do jointly. So I'm less worried about people forming for reasons that come around their practice areas. So if you go to APHA, there's fabulous programming across the way, but maybe your specific area has 1 hour. And you're not going to APHA necessarily for that 1 hour. But if you want to really advance your skills in your area, meeting of the emergency pharmacist might be the best one to go to. So there's maybe some, they've clashed on some ideas, and it happens at JCPP too. I've served on it twice, so I got to see how it goes. But I think in general, when they focus on advancing patient care and the profession, they come together on the ideas. So I would say some, but not the whole thing. Probably more of our lack of advancement in many ways is the alignment of reimbursement and how things are paid. So, like in community pharmacy, we get paid for getting a prescription out. We should be paid for not getting a prescription if the patient doesn't need it, but we're not. MTM does a lot of that in those kinds of services. So alignment of the reimbursement is important. But I still see everybody pushing forward. I think pharmacists are doing what they can to move forward, whether or not we get these specific reimbursement varieties. I'm excited about the profession. I always tell my pharmacy students, make sure you're learning a lot, because I'm going to be needing you shortly. So I expect a very good job. And I'm one that needs it.
question over here? No. I'm sorry. You're assisting. Any other questions?
I know I'm in the way of lunch, so I do understand that part.
Well, if there's no further questions, John, as a token of our appreciation, the University of Mississippi would like to present you with the Coy W. Waller Distinguished Lecturer Award in recognition of your outstanding service and dedication to excellence in pharmacy practice as a role model, mentor, and clinical educator. Joining us to honor the legacy of Dr. Waller. Enjoy the rest of your day. Thank you again.